Well, I had a really interesting experience with a patient in 1968. This was a patient who had chronic angina pectoris, and we were trying an experimental treatment of angina, and that was to stimulate the carotid sinuses. The patient had a power source hooked to his belt with a button, and he would press the button every time he developed severe angina, or sometimes before he developed angina, but he knew he was going to get it because he was going to exercise. Well, this is certainly not a treatment that has lasted, but we did learn a great deal from it. And what I learned from one patient with this device was really quite interesting. We had told our patients that if the pain persisted or got worse while they had the device on, that is, while they were stimulating their carotid sinus nerves, they should stop, because we were afraid that that would drop the blood pressure too low in somebody who was having a myocardial infarction. And this gentleman was having a myocardial infarction, and he came into our hospital. This was the clinical center of the National Institutes of Health at the time. When I saw him, I noticed that he had the stimulator on, which was contrary to instructions. And I turned it off and I said, you know, you really shouldn't have this on. He was being taken care of by the team. They were doing a great job. I went back to my office. A half hour later, I returned in order to see how he was doing. He seemed to be doing fine, but he had the stimulator on. And a second time, I turned it off. And the second time, I said, you know, you shouldn't have it on. Well, sure enough, a half hour later, I returned a second time, and the stimulator is on again. And I turned it off, and this time I took the stimulator away from him. I said, let me hold on to that for the next couple of hours, but you'll get it back once we are over this myocardial infarction after the acute event. And I then analyzed the electrocardiogram, and to my surprise, when the stimulator was on, his ST segments, which indicate ischemia, were very low, about a half a millimeter. When I turned the stimulator off, the ST segments signifying ischemia rose up to about 3 millimeters, indicating severe ischemia. Now, I didn't notice that at the time, only after reviewing his ECG. And the other two times, the same thing happened. He turns it on, the ST segments normalize, I come along and turn it off, and the ST segments go up. So this happened a couple of times, as I mentioned. And then I began to think about this. And I said, well, I had always thought that a myocardial infarction was a sudden event. And even in the classic paper described by Herrick, that described the clinical features of myocardial infarction, it talked about sudden obstruction of the coronary artery. So to me, and to other people at the time, this is back in 1968, it was like a patient getting a myocardial infarction was like throwing a light switch off. It's on, the clot comes along, and the light switch is off, and of course you can't restore it. Now, what this patient showed was it is not an all-at-once phenomenon, because he was going through very severe ischemia, and then much reduced ischemia. And it occurred to me that it might be possible to influence an infarct once it had started. So that the analogy that I use now, it's like a rheostat that you gradually turn down. If you turn it down all the way, of course the lights are off, but it's not an off-on switch. And while the rheostat is turning down, that you do have time to intervene. And this concept, this idea, festered in my mind. And several months later, my colleagues and I began to do experiments in dogs, in which we, not with a carotid sinus stimulator, but in which we opened and closed coronary arteries. We studied what happens if a coronary artery is closed with a clamp, and what if after 30 minutes you unclamp it. What happens to a coronary artery, or what happens to the myocardium if you give a drug that reduces the oxygen demand, like a beta blocker, and that also had a beneficial effect. So we concluded in 1971 in a paper that we published in Circulation that that if a patient who's having a myocardial infarction reaches the hospital early enough, then either mechanical reperfusion or alternatively reducing the oxygen requirements of the heart with a beta blocker or drugs such as that could spare the myocardium. And we were able to show consistently that we could reduce infarct size by these various maneuvers. And that was certainly the most exciting experience of my professional life. The limitation of infarct size has been really one of the overwhelming goals that I've had over the years after the experiments that I've just described. And obviously my interest has shifted to patients, because while the work was done in dogs, the idea of doing this in patients is what was uppermost in our minds. What we learned at that time is that patients who died of a heart attack, an acute myocardial infarction, if they didn't have an arrhythmia, which was a sudden death, if they developed heart failure, cardiogenic shock, and then died, which, by the way, happened to about 15% of the patients at that time, then at autopsy, they were found uniformly to have very large infarcts, usually about upwards of 35 to 40% of their left ventricles were infarcted. So that added another element of a push to try to limit infarct size. I think if we now sort of move up by half a century, you know, one asks the question, is this still important? And I would answer with a resounding yes. The methods for measuring infarct size have moved out of the pathology laboratory, and they moved to the clinic, where by using imaging techniques, especially magnetic resonance imaging of the heart, it's possible to measure infarct size directly in a living patient. And when that's done, and you line up the sizes of infarcts, the small infarcts do not lead to complications. Larger infarcts do. They often cause heart failure. Very large infarcts can produce cardiogenic shock, which may be fatal. And super large ones result in death very rapidly. So there is a spectrum of infarct sizes, and I think the goal remains as it did half century ago, that you want to find ways of reducing infarct size and do it safely. So we've come a long way, really, in management of myocardial infarction. I think that in most series now, the mortality is about 5%, and that comes from the combination of reperfusion, early reperfusion by percutaneous intervention with stenting. And this has been a major breakthrough. But there are still some areas that need to be tackled. A 5% mortality that we now see as a terrific victory is great when you compare it to the 30% mortality that we saw when I began my training. By all evaluations, 5% is way too high. We really should be able to get it down to the mortality of an uncomplicated appendectomy, which is about a 0.25%. So how are we going to go about doing that? Well, if I knew how to do it, I'd have done it. But these are the areas that need more work. First of all, there is a process called reperfusion injury. So if you open an occluded vessel, and you have to open it in order to keep the tissue alive, that inrush of blood also causes damage, reperfusion damage. So about half of the benefit that we get from reperfusion, now usually by percutaneous intervention, half of that is gone. And there are many experiments that have been carried out in animal models that give some hints as to how to do this. But it has been a very vexing question, and we tried to extend these observations to patients, but have not yet been successful. But, you know, this is still early. I mean, this whole field only began 50 years ago, which is a blink of your eye in human history. So I'm sure that will be accomplished, and that will be a great boon. The other area where we need to make some radical changes are patients who, even though they're reperfused, even though they've gotten beta blockers, you've done everything you possibly can, and they go into cardiogenic shock. They still have large infarcts, and in cardiogenic shock, they are at risk, very high risk of death. People have tried a variety of drugs, and the drugs improve the numbers, like what the pressure is and what the ejection fraction is, but they do not prolong life. People have tried intra-aortic balloon counterpulsation, which has been around for a long time, and that transiently increases the blood pressure, but it does not save lives. Now there are a group of new perfusion apparatuses, really, pumps that can be applied in the catheterization laboratory. which take the blood from one part of the circulation. For example, there's one called the Tandem Art, which takes blood from the left atrium. Left atrium has been entered with a transseptal catheter, and then pumps that blood into the femoral artery, thereby raising the pressure and raising the equivalent of cardiac output. And there are others. Now, they look promising, but they have been applied too late, I believe. It's the same as if you say, well, reperfusion is terrific. We want to reperfuse the ischemic myocardium, and if we do this at 15 hours, it's not going to work. It's got to be done within the first 3 hours, and preferably in the first 60 minutes. And I think it's the same with cardiogenic shock. I think that our treatment of cardiogenic shock is to do everything you possibly can. And then only then you fall back on one of these devices. And I think that that's a paradigm that has to shift, because if the patient is in cardiogenic shock, they're inevitably going to destroy tissue, lung, liver, kidneys, and then even though you may put in what amounts to a mechanical support for the heart, and it will put up more blood and improve the ejection fraction and make all the numbers look better, you're not really helping the patient, because the patient is irreversibly injured. So there are some areas in myocardial infarction. Myocardial infarction still is one of the commonest causes of death. And I am disappointed that research on reducing infarct size, because we have been so successful, seems to have stopped. And I think, you know, with the several hundred thousand patients who have myocardial infarction a year in the United States, I think we should be focusing on reducing the mortality from 5% to 1%. Many of these patients are in the prime of life, and we really shouldn't be losing these patients as we still are.